you're joining us for worship today, whether you're here in the room or you're joining us online, we're thankful to be worshiping together with you. If this is your first time joining us here at The Grove, we want to say a special welcome to you. My name is Jenny, and I get to serve on staff here. We hope you've already gotten to meet some people as you've come in, but when you walked in the door, you should have been handed a bulletin, and at the back of this is what we call our Connect card. We would love for you to take just a minute and fill out this Connect card and let us know that you're here with us today. After service, we want to invite you over to Guest Central over here where the doors are lit up, and we'll have a small gift to say thank you for joining us, and then most importantly, would love to learn your story and hear how it is that you've come to join us at The Grove, and if we can help connect you in any way, if you're looking to belong or find a church family, we would love to do that, so please don't let us miss out on that. And church family, as always, in the bulletin, there's really important information when you open that up and look on the left-hand side. One thing, we had such a great turnout this past fall that tomorrow, Sunday, and Monday, we have two more wills and trusts meetings. Pastor Tom had talked about this last fall in one of his sermons. This is a great way to steward your finances and your life and prepare for what's coming. So if you want to join us, check out thegrove.cc or up on the slide, you can see that information. And then next weekend, we are celebrating life in Jesus with baptism. So if you or someone in your small group or in your family is interested in getting baptized, we would love to talk with you. And so after service, we will have a staff member up here to the right as well that you can come and talk about getting baptized next weekend. We want to celebrate with you, especially this year as we're following Jesus and our whole focus is following him and making disciples. We want to be about that work. And then when you keep reading those announcements, we've got a lot of classes coming up, opportunities to grow this year, opportunities to learn more about God, learn about what we can be about, engage with the community. We have refugees coming this year, and we as a church want to be ready to welcome them. So please read and look and then connect and serve with us in those ways. So we're going to have a time of worship. If you would stand with us, we're going to begin worship now.
Well, good evening, Grove. Listen to the...
We'll be right back.
raise a hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. Come on. And I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. Sing it out, church. And I raise a hallelujah. even in the midst of everything that's going on in this crazy world. I mean, it's been a crazy couple of years, yeah? Anybody out there had a crazy couple of years? I know I for sure have. It's been wild. But knowing that in the midst of all of these things, that because of the great love of God, that we can hold on to that, church. That is the thing that we hold on to. If you try to hold on to your families, they will one day be gone. If you try to hold on to wealth, it one day will be gone. If you pursue after power, one day it will be gone. But the only thing that lasts is the gospel and Jesus Christ. That is the only thing. Is someone gonna clap for that tonight? In the book of Ephesians 3, Paul is talking about the mystery of the gospel. And he prays this prayer over the church. He prays this prayer. He says, in 3, verse 16, he says that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, the church, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all of the saints, that means all of us, what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses all knowledge and understanding, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. That's the prayer over us tonight, church, that we would understand how deep, how wide, how vast the love of God is for us. And that's what we hold on to. So let's sing this song together. How deep the Father's love for us, the love that came for us, that sent his one and only Son to come and die in our place. This is what we hold on to, church. Listen to this.
Thank you.
Good to see y'all this evening. Why don't you guys turn and greet someone who's near you?
Aligns our teaching, it aligns our vision and all the different ministries here at the mid-October, November. That's when we kind of have our vision series for 2022 and what's coming. It's centered around Mark 1:17, where Jesus says, "Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men." So this whole year is going to be dedicated to looking at what does it really mean to follow Jesus. This is great for someone who is not a believer. This is great for someone who is a believer, looking at, are we doing everything that the Lord Jesus wants us to do? Now, even looking at this theme verse, we can see that God doesn't just want us to follow him for ourselves and give him glory, but Jesus says, "Follow me and I will make you become fishers of men." That Jesus wants us to follow him and bring others along with us so that together we can all give God glory that he deserves. That is the goal, to have other people follow him as well after he's changed our life. Now, when we begun this this vision for 2022, we introduced 46 different initiatives, love offering initiatives, projects that we wanted to do as a church to make disciples here in Riverside and around the world. We asked our church back in October and November to pledge or give $1 million above normal giving, tithes, and offerings so that we could do these extra projects, because we're a church that loves to do outreach, and our church stepped up in generosity. Wanted to tell you, at the end of December right now, we're at this number right here, $1,385,150.01. That's fantastic. That's amazing. Great work for that. Not all of that has come in. A lot of that has been given. Some have been pledged to give throughout this year. I've said this before, anything given above $1 million will go to pay down debt, and a generous family in the church will match that amount. Last year, pledges were like at 1.2, and almost 1.5 came in. So really, God's doing some great things. We're very excited to see what he's going to do through these love offering initiatives. We have a residency program that's starting out, looks like a communion cup just fell here. last week, Trevor, I see you over there. We have a residency program starting up. We're going to train up two pastors and either help them go overseas, church plant, or revitalize the church that's struggling with the Christian Missionary Alliance, Southern Baptist. We're going to partner in supporting five new global outreach partners. We're partnering with five different church plants around not the country, but around the world that we're excited about, and 35 other initiatives that I don't have time to talk about, but a lot of exciting things. We're also going to be going through a new book in the Bible, starting in January, starting right now, the book of Mark. So reintroducing that. Now, if you're here in October and November, we already went through chapter 1. We spent 4 weeks in chapter 1. So if you missed that, go online, listen to all four tonight. I'm sure all of you will do that. Now here's the thing. There's 16 chapters in the book of Mark. We have 15 left. We're not going to spend 4 weeks per chapter, because that would take 60 weeks for us to go through the book. We're not going to do that. We're actually going to take the next 15 weeks to go through the book of Mark, one chapter a week. Interesting enough, I think it's interesting, Easter's in 15 weeks. So we're going to finish Mark. We're going to finish Mark 16 on Easter, where it talks about the resurrection of Jesus. Now, something else, as we go through each chapter, typically in each chapter there's 3, 4, 5 different stories and different settings. So it's really going to be impossible for myself or the person teaching to go through them all. So what we're going to do is we're going to break it up. Even today, you'll see this. I'll talk through two of the stories in Mark chapter 2. Then on Monday, we're going to have a devotional on social media called Follow Up. Get it? Isn't it cute? Like, follow me, follow up. Where the person will share devotion on the passages that we missed. It's only going to be a 5 to 10 minute devotion. And the intent is to help our congregation to study the other passages, because we want you to dive into God's word as well and study it together as a church. So I'm excited about that. So this week I'm going to be focusing in on Mark chapter 2, 1 through 17. Our high school pastor, David Reynolds, will cover Mark chapter 2, 18 through 36 in the follow-up devotion. Now, before I start reading Mark chapter 2, I want us to spend some time about the background of this book as we become familiar with it, and we're going to spend the next 15 weeks in here. Starting with the author. Who is the author of Mark? It starts with an M and ends with a K. If you guessed Maverick, you were incorrect. You're watching too much Top Gun. It's Mark, okay? Okay, so point number one in your notes, who is Mark? Mark is the author of this book. Well, Mark's full name was John Mark. We hear a little bit about him and his mom in Acts chapter 12, verse 12. His mother's name was Mary. She lived in Jerusalem, and she appeared to have a bigger home because this is where a lot of the early believers would go and meet and do Bible studies. Mark was also cousins with Barnabas. If you're familiar with the Bible, Paul and Barnabas did a lot of missionary journeys together. In fact, they brought Barnabas' cousin Mark with them. And Mark is the one responsible for really breaking up that friendship for a time. Why? Because Mark decided to go home. We don't know if he just missed Mary, was a little homesick, but he went home. Paul and Barnabas got into an argument because Paul didn't want to bring Mark on the next missionary voyage, so they went their separate ways. Good news is Paul and Mark end up having a little reunion later on, and all is good. Sometimes that happens, even with the people that we see in Scripture. So we see this. Now, other interesting things just to know about the author, Mark. Mark was not an eyewitness to Jesus. I think that's fascinating. Mark is not one of the 12 disciples either. So we're like, why is this guy writing about this? Well, evidence from the early church fathers, specifically a guy named Papias, apparently wrote this down in like 95 AD, talks about how Peter is the one that actually passed on the words and deeds of Jesus to his attendant, to his personal writer named Mark. That Mark is actually the writer of Peter. So really what we're reading when we read through the book of Mark is we're reading Peter's version of everything that happened. It's Peter who stands behind Mark's gospel. Mark is just the writer. Now, this one makes sense because if you go through all the Gospels, all four Gospels, Mark's account is especially vivid when recounting all of the different stories that involve Peter. And not only are they like very clear on Peter, but it's very negative towards Peter and the other disciples. All the stuff in the Gospels that have like encouraging things to say about Peter are in Matthew and Luke, not in Mark. So you can picture Peter telling the story, just very humble, sharing these things that happened to Mark, and Mark wrote these down. All the praiseworthy comments about Peter are in Matthew and Luke. Now, I've said before, too, the book of Mark is known as being the shortest of the four Gospels and the least popular of the four Gospels. This has gone back for a long time. How many people have you ever asked this question? What's your favorite Gospel? Not many people say Mark. It's like, oh, John, I love chapter 1, just the deity of Christ. Oh, Luke, I love Lucas. I love Matthew. I mean, just so detailed. No one really says Mark. So you may be wondering, like, why are we going through Mark? I mean, how many preaching series have you gone through Mark? I mean, usually it's like, we're going to go through Luke. We're going to go through John. We're going to go through Mark. So why is it the least popular? Well, here's the thing. It's not because it's not good. It's because it has the least amount of original stories in it. In fact, I read that 95% of the stories of Mark can be found in Matthew and Luke as well. So if you want to read Matthew, you're going to hear a bunch of other stories. You're going to read Luke and a bunch of other stories. Now, even just regards to the Gospels, there's four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Really, it's just one Gospel. We have one Gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. But these are accounts of the Gospel that have been written to different areas depending upon where these writers were. So you have, for example, Mark is believed to be written to the Romans because that's where Mark was. Now, another thing about Mark, of just the information that I shared to you, because 95% of the stories are covered in in Matthew and Luke, most scholars believe that Mark was the first Gospel written out of them all. Because why in the world would Mark decide to write another gospel that has the exact same stories as Matthew and Luke? Scholars will even say the way he wrote it, just even the verbiage of it, the style of it, is very poor compared to the other ones. But what they believe happened is that Mark is the first person to write it. Matthew and Luke actually used it as a guide and added to things that he hadn't thrown in there from what they saw and experienced themselves. So here's the reason why I think you should love Mark. Mark was probably picture this, and this is where it gets interesting. You start reading all these commentaries and people arguing about when this was written. People, scholars will argue that it was either written in the mid-50s, AD 50. Let's just say Jesus died around AD 33. Some people think that this was written AD 50, mid-60s or mid-70s, and there's no consensus of when it is. But more than likely, that people also say that Peter died in AD 64. So Mark is probably hearing Peter talk about all of these things, coming to the point of realizing, okay, I need to write this down because Peter's about to die, or Peter just died. And church history actually has Mark writing this stuff down while he's in Italy for the Roman people who were waiting for the Messiah. Now, something also interesting that we'll think through as we go through this, you don't see the title Messiah or Christ very often in Mark. Why? Because he's writing to the Romans. The Romans want the Messiah. They want a conqueror to come in and absolutely destroy the Roman Empire that has them captive. So what does Mark use? He uses the title Son of Man over and over again. In fact, 14 times he uses this to show that it's the Son of Man that came, a human. It's the Son of Man that died. It's the Son of Man that rose again, proving it to deity. It's the Son of Man that Daniel prophesies in Daniel chapter 7 is going to come back again in glory. So it's very unique, this title written to the Roman people who wanted a soldier, a nationalist to come in and destroy. He goes, no, this is the Son of Man, the Son of God who has come. So all of these things that we're learning along the way. Other things you'll notice about Mark is to the point. It's fast-paced. I said this back in October, November. He says immediately all the time, 41 times, immediately this happened. Immediately this happened. The stories are not linear. You can't say this is a biography of Jesus' life. Not talking about his birth story, about Mary and Joseph, none of those things. It's like a highlight reel. The other day, Johnny and Graham woke up early in the morning. They watched the top 100 catches on YouTube. They do this all the time. 100 best catches ever in NFL history. You know, it was like number 18, I think it was, Tim Tebow. His throw against the Steelers in the playoffs. I couldn't believe it. Anyways, Mark is like a highlight reel. Just here's the big moments of Jesus' life. These are the things we want you to know. Now, point number two, the purpose of Mark. The purpose of Mark is to know Jesus and to understand his call to discipleship. To know how and what it means to have a relationship with Jesus and to follow after him. So yes, Mark wants us to know who Jesus is. We see this in Mark chapter 1, verse 1. Starts off saying the beginning of the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. He is the Messiah. The Romans would want to hear at least that part right there. He is the Son of God. I'm going to tell you the good news of the kingdom that has come through Jesus Christ. So Mark wants us to know Jesus, but he also wants to know what Jesus wanted from his followers, which is why you see this big statement in Mark 1:17, very beginning of the gospel, follow me and I will make you become fishers of men. I'm going to turn you in to a disciple maker. So this is one thing that we actually see now Mark does in the style of his writing. As he's talking to the crowds, he begins to separate them into two groups. He separates them into regards like, here's the followers and how the followers are going to respond, and here's the opponents and how the opponents are going to respond. In fact, in Mark chapter 2, verse 1 to Mark chapter 3, verse 6, you see that Mark brings up five different opponents, groups of Jesus, of saying, here's the people that were against Jesus. Here are the opponents of Jesus. And then also kind of showing us, well, here's the ones that actually follow Jesus. So those who are reading this are kind of faced with the question of this: am I a follower of Jesus or am I an opponent of Jesus? You're one or the other. And that's something that's tough to think about. Because that's what Jesus says, makes it very clear in Matthew. You're either for me or you're against me. You're either a follower of Jesus, Mark is telling us, or you're in complete opposition of Jesus. You are an opponent of Jesus. And we're going to see that in the first two stories that we read today. So I even hope and pray, I have been praying for you, that you didn't think about your own life. Are you following Jesus? Were you living in opposition to him? Let's look at Mark chapter 2, 1 through 12. Mark 2, 1 through 12, as we'll spend the first amount of time. It says, a few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. They gathered in such large numbers that there was no room left, not even outside the door, and he preached the word to them. Some men came bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. So Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it and then lowered the mat the man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now some teachers of the law were sitting there thinking to themselves, "Why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Immediately Jesus knew in his spirit that this was what they were thinking in their hearts, and he said to them, "Why are you thinking these things? Which is easier to say to this paralyzed man, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up, take your mat, and walk?' But I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." So he said to them, "I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home." He got up, took his mat, and walked out in full view of them all. This amazed everyone, and they praised God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." That's a great story. The big overarching idea of this story, the main takeaway from this story, is point number 3 on your notes, that Jesus, he's the forgiver of sins. That's the main goal of Mark writing this story. It's the main reason why he actually healed this man. He wants us to see that Jesus forgives sins. Now, the story starts off with Jesus coming home. If you remember back to October and November, the story, chapter 1 actually ends with Jesus going to different towns in Galilee, preaching the gospel, and he told his disciples, "This is why I have come." So he's out preaching all over the place. He comes home to Capernaum, is where he's spending some time, and a crowd develops outside of the house that he's in. Now, this is also something that Mark does in his writing. He's constantly talking about the crowds early on in the first couple of chapters, showing Jesus' fame. It starts right from the beginning of his ministry. It grew fast. So he comes home. People found out. They gathered in such large numbers that there was no room for them, even outside the door. Now, scholars say that Jesus was possibly at Peter's house when this happened. So there's so many things going on. There's a lot of people there. Jesus just come back. So what does Jesus do? Jesus preached the word to them. Now, the people who were checking Jesus out, they're probably looking for a miracle. They were probably looking for a sign. They heard a lot of things about who this Jesus was. They wanted to see it for themselves. What did Jesus give them? He gave them preaching. He preached. He constantly preached God's word, continuing his call to repent and believe the kingdom of God is here. And Jesus gives this example and shows us that preaching has to be a part of our ministry. We have to preach the word of God. That lives are changed when we preach God's word. It's where we learn about the kingdom of God, the rule of God, the forgiveness of God, the goodness that Jesus brings, that he is the Messiah, the Son of God. There's a reason why Jesus came and preached every single where that they the word of God changes people's lives. So while Jesus is doing his thing, and Jesus is preaching like he always does, we see all throughout the beginning of the Gospel of Mark, 4 men come making their way to Jesus, carrying a paralyzed man, but they couldn't get to him. Why? Because the crowds were just too big. There were a lot of barriers in the way, but yet it didn't stop them. So they apparently took an outside staircase to the top of the roof. History says that the roofs would have been flat during this time, made of sticks and branches and clay, and they begin to dig through a hole. So as they're doing this, you even have to picture this in your mind. I mean, more than likely they're inside and dirt is starting to fall on top and people's looking up and dirt's starting to hit them, maybe even hitting Jesus in the head. And they see this hole emerge and a man began to be lowered down. Now, if it's Peter's house, Peter may be losing his mind. Like, what are you doing to my roof? For Jesus, in my mind, I picture him smiling. And look at what these people are doing right now and bringing this man to me. I think he was loving it. In fact, it says that when Jesus saw their faith, he looked at the man and said, "Your sins are forgiven." Point number 3, again, Jesus, forgiver of sins. Now, looking at followers of Jesus and what followers of Jesus do, followers of Jesus believe that Jesus can meet their deepest need. We believe that. So we want to come to Jesus. Our deepest needs, we come to him. These 4 men who were carrying their crippled friend to Jesus believed that Jesus could meet their deepest need and provide healing. And they were right. Where they were wrong is about what their friend's deepest need actually was. Their friend's deepest need was not needing to walk again, but their friend's deepest need was needing to be forgiven. That's the greatest thing that Jesus could have done for him. Forgiveness is the greatest thing that Jesus can do for us. That is our deepest need as human beings, needing to be forgiven. Commentator, scholar Daniel Aiken says this about Jesus: seeing the man's whole situation, Jesus lovingly looked past his surface need and met his deeper need. He looked past the man's immediate need and met his real need. And Jesus did this based upon who he is, being the Son of God. He also did this based upon what he was going to do, dying on the cross for our sins. He forgave this paralyzed man and gave him a full and complete pardon of sin. Really, it's incredible. And the religious leaders saw this, and it talks about how they immediately accused Jesus of blasphemy. Interesting enough, the very charge that would get Jesus crucified in Mark chapter 14. That's what gets him crucified. Why? He's claiming to be God. So the religious leader said in verse 7, who can forgive sins but God alone? Now here's the things about the religious leaders. They're actually correct at this moment. Who can forgive sins but God alone? And they were right. Only God can forgive sins. I mean, these words would have for sure been blasphemous unless Jesus is in fact God. So when we see Jesus coming and forgiving this man's sin, he's really making a statement to every single person that's there. I am God. I have the power to do this. He claims this, which is why followers of Jesus believe Jesus can meet our deepest needs, because God is the only one that can forgive us of our sins. That's why we run to Jesus. That's why we love Jesus. That's why we praise Jesus. Not just because he helps us in our time of need, but because he helps us with our deepest need. Our sin that keeps us away from the Father, that we should be damned in hell. And yet Jesus comes and says, I'm going to help you. I'm going to help you with that deepest need. And followers of Jesus understand that Jesus can take care of the deepest need. We know that. Our greatest need is for Jesus himself. We need Jesus because we have sin that needs to be forgiven. And Jesus shows us this in forgiving the paralytic man who comes to him. Under point number 3, after talking about Jesus' forgiver of sins and followers, here's the next line for opponents. Opponents of Jesus, they refuse to believe Jesus can meet their deepest need. That's what an opponent is. They literally refuse. I'm not going to believe that. I don't believe that you are God. Now, isn't it interesting? In them refusing to believe that Jesus is God, who's the one who just committed blasphemy? The religious leaders are. I mean, they're claiming that Jesus is the one who just said something full of blasphemy. And blasphemy is great disrespect towards God. And yet they're telling the Son of God, they're telling God himself, you're not God. You cannot do this. So even picture this in your mind. If you don't believe that Jesus is God, that's blasphemy. If you don't believe that Jesus can forgive you of your sins, it's blasphemy. And therefore, you're telling God he's not who he says he is, and therefore you're an opponent of him. You're against him. You're saying what you say about yourself is not true. So either for him or you're against him. And Mark is helping us see this. So this is where I think it gets intense, even in raising this question of what you believe. Now, I'm guessing there's someone here who wouldn't call themselves a follower of Jesus right now. Have you ever thought of yourself as an opponent of him, going against him? You're either for him, you believe, and you follow, or you don't, you deny, you disrespect the truth of who your Creator is. It has to settle in our hearts. Now, Jesus knew the religious leaders didn't believe him. He knew this, which is why he said this question. Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up, take your mat, and go? I mean, you can practice saying which one's easier. It pretty much sounds the same for how we say it. Which one really is easier? say your sins are forgiven. Why? Because we don't know if they really were. And we're not really for sure. I mean, he just said that, but how is anyone supposed to know if that guy's sin is really forgiven? There's no proof it happened. Which is why Mark 2:10 says, but I want you to know that the Son of Man, there's that title, Son of Man, has authority on earth to forgive sins. So he said to the man, I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home. And this is exactly what he does. So the point is that Jesus does a miracle they can see in making this man walk to prove that he can forgive sins and do what they can't see. That's the whole point of miracle. And even Trevor brought this up. A lot of times we see miracles happen in Scripture. I'm like, well, why don't we see the miracles happen in our life? Now, why is that? Well, if you're asking for a miracle and it doesn't come, it doesn't mean that God's not real. What God does offer to each and every single one of us is forgiveness of sins. That is the greatest miracle. The lesser miracle just proved what Jesus does in our hearts. That was the point of it. Now, application questions, just to think through before we move on to the next story. Application questions. Do you believe that Jesus can forgive you of your sins? I think that's the greatest question that I could ask you right now. If you believe that, and you haven't given your life to him, give your life to him. Say, Jesus, I want you to come into my life. I believe you died on the cross for my sins. I believe that you are God Almighty. I want you to be my Lord. We'll pray with you. You're saved by that confession of faith in him. If you don't believe, you're an opponent. Next question. Is there a friend that you need to bring to Jesus? I've heard this passage preached different times, and that's one of them. Just focusing in on those four friends that brought their friend to Jesus. And as we talk about discipleship throughout this year, I think one of the things that we'll even think about is that discipleship happens in community groups. It's not just you saying, okay, I'm going to focus on that one person, just me and them, I'm going to bring them to Jesus. But really, it's a group of people. It's a small group of people. It's multiple people pouring into that person and saying, I'm going to find a way. We're going to find a way to bring this person to Jesus. Next question. This one came from Kristen Warner, study time. Are you a part of the crowd that got in the way of someone coming to Jesus, or a part of the group that's finding a way for someone to come to Jesus? It is interesting to even think about it. The people who went to the house are wanting to listen to Jesus, but they're kind of in the way. And yet there's four people trying to provide a way. Makes me think about that. Are we providing ways for people to come to the Lord? Next question. In your own life, are you letting any barriers get in the way of you coming to Jesus? Is anything keeping you from coming from him? I mean, even for this paralyzed man, it was the crowd, it was the ladder, it was the roof, it was being lowered down, but nothing got in the way. Next, how are you being led to show radical faith that believes God can do anything? What risks are you willing to take? What is it that God wants you to do that may just be a little bit radical in your life, and yet you're going to come to him because you know he's asking you to come to him? Let's go to the second story that we're going to spend time looking at today, Mark 2:13-17. Mark 2:13-17. It says, once again, Jesus went out beside the lake. A large crowd came to him. There's Mark talking about this large crowd again. And he began to teach them. As he walked along, he saw Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me. There's those words again. Follow me, Jesus told him. And Levi got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. But the teachers of the law, who were Pharisees, saw him eating with the sinners and tax collectors. They asked his disciples, why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? On hearing this, Jesus said to them, it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners. Another great story here. And the main overarching point of even this passage that we just read right here, point number four in your notes, that Jesus is a friend of sinners. So the first one we saw, first story, Jesus is forgiver of sins. The second one here, Jesus is friend of sinners. Two main ideas in these stories that we read, the forgiver of sins and the friend of sinners, and that we're either followers or opponents of him. In this last story, we see Jesus is walking by the sea when he sees Levi at the tax collector booth. Which tells us this, that Levi was more than likely someone that taxed the fishermen. Jesus is walking by the sea. He sees Levi over there, also known guy who probably taxed the fishermen as they came in. It's also probably the man that the disciples hated the least, or hated the most, not the least, but the most. So Jesus calls out to this man, "Follow me." The calling had to be compelling for Matthew. I mean, why would Jesus want me, an evil man, to follow after him? You want me? Maybe he just talks about just the sincerity of the call, the love of the call, the authority of the call. So what does Matthew do? Matthew, Levi, he leaves everything and he follows Jesus. In fact, Levi was so happy he throws a party at his house for Jesus, the disciples, and all of Levi's friends, sinners and tax collectors. Come on, come to my house. Come to my house. You have to see this man that I just quit everything for. You have to come and see him. The disciples were invited, and it was two worlds coming together as one. Have you ever had that experience before, where you have your believing friends and your unbelieving friends coming together in the same place, and you're kind of wondering, like, how's this going to go when the two worlds combine, wondering what that's going to look like? If you look at the ESV version of this story, it talks about how Jesus, he reclined at the table. More than likely, he's in the middle. I mean, he's just hanging out with the sinners and the tax collectors, like, no big deal. Now, while this is going on, the teachers of the law, known as the Pharisees, were outside of Levi's house peeking in. This is what you did before social media was going on back then. You had to go to their house and just spy on them. Look at their house. What are they doing? What's going on? And they saw Jesus eating with tax collectors, sinners, and they're thinking, why does he do this? Why would this man, who considers himself to be Son of God, hang out with people who don't even follow the different purity laws of cleaning and food laws and all of these things? Why would he do that and act like he approves of what they are doing? Now, you have to understand just a little bit about the Pharisees. The Pharisees were these self-righteous rulers who did their best to obey God's law and then even created like another law to make sure that they wouldn't disobey God's law. They were legalists. In fact, the name Pharisee in Hebrew means a separatist. They would separate themselves from the common people. They would actually separate themselves from those that they thought were in sin because they couldn't be around them in the things that they would do. And yet God shows us the exact opposite of who they were. That Jesus, the Son of God, does not separate himself from sinners. That would make no sense at all. But Jesus actually, he runs to them. He wants to be with them. So Jesus heard them mumbling and said to them, a well-known proverb of that time. He says, it's not the healthy who need the doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinners. Point number four in your notes, Jesus is a friend of sinners, and followers of Jesus intentionally befriend sinners. This is what we should see, that followers of Jesus want to be around people who do not have a relationship with Jesus. Why? Well, because sinners need Jesus. Followers of Jesus recognize that we're sinners. Followers of Jesus understand that we're sinners, that we need to be saved. We understand that God Almighty befriended us and drew us into a relationship with him, and therefore we have to be strategic in doing the same for other people. Sinners need Jesus. Jesus didn't come to call the righteous, but he came to call sinners. And really, that was a jab at the Pharisees. Why? Because the Pharisees thought that they were righteous. And they weren't. There's no one righteous, not one. There's no one that's good. Every single one of us is a sinner. We're all sinners. It's just the Pharisees really didn't believe at that point in time. Opponents of Jesus, they separate themselves from sinners. They act holier than thou. They separate themselves from Jesus. They separate themselves from Jesus' mission and what he cared for. But notice that no one was too bad of a sinner for Jesus to pursue. Jesus was a friend of sinners. He loved sinners. He cared for sinners. He spent time to be with them, which makes sense, right? Because Jesus is the Savior of sinners. He has to be around them. Now, isn't it interesting that Jesus hanging out with sinners could have been so shocking and foreign to the fake spiritual religious leaders of that day? I mean, why were these people so surprised by that? Well, I think it's just because many times in culture sets up these norms of what religion is really like. Sometimes we just have to get back to the Word of God and just do what God's even puts fear into my own life of wondering, God, is there any cultural religious stuff that's going on in this day and age? Maybe I'm not even aware of it. I'm not even doing it because culture just says this is how I'm supposed to act. I mean, Jesus just did what God called him to do, to go and save the lost. And if we're going to save the lost, we actually have to be with the lost. I mean, the fake over-righteous people were offended by what Jesus did. And yet, this is what Jesus was called to do. May we never be like the Pharisees. Notice Jesus intentionally spent time with sinners. Notice this too. They liked him. They liked Jesus. The unbelievers accepted Jesus enough to want to eat with him. They wanted to be with him. And he reclined with them. I mean, they wanted to be around him. That Jesus didn't just go off and tell them all the bad things that they were doing. Jesus didn't say, hey, don't talk like that. Hey, you should have washed your hands before you ate that. Hey, don't eat that food right there. That's a Jewish law. Why are you doing that? Jesus is just hanging out with people who have no relationship with him at all. And the people who are not believers, they're like attracted to him. They like him. They're interested in him. They want to be around him. I think that's interesting when you look at Jesus and the way that he treats people all throughout the Gospels. You don't see Jesus get too upset where he's just like coming down on unbelievers. Who does he come down on? He comes down on the Pharisees. He comes down on those who act like they know it all and are just so religious, and those who are like misrepresenting who God was. That's who Jesus goes after. Those are the people that just get on Jesus' nerves. But the people that Jesus just loves, the ones that he just cares for, who just has compassion and grace, I just want to be with you, are those who are the furthest away, the ones who have the worst sin, the ones that society rejected, and those people, they wanted to be with Jesus too. They felt loved by him. They felt cared for by him. And you know what? As believers, we have to keep this in our mind. Outsiders, sinners, they should want to be around us. Outsiders, sinners, people who have not come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, they should think well of us. In fact, that's one of the qualifications for an elder. To be a pastor, an elder, it talks about how they should be thought well of by outsiders. That people who aren't Christians should be like, wow, actually, that's a solid guy. It's a solid person of how they live their lives. I mean, if unbelievers, think about this, if unbelievers don't like us and they just think we're a bunch of crazy lunatics who are too good, why in the world would they ever want to follow Jesus at all? So let me ask you this. Do unbelievers like you? Do they like you? Do unbelievers want to be around you? Do they think well of you? Now, I know this takes balance for the church, especially in these times where the world's getting darker and darker and is pulling away from biblical truth. I mean, how do we stand up for what is true and biblical and not look over righteous? At the same time, how do we not separate ourselves like the Pharisees did, where we kind of just gather with our Christian friends and it's like, oh my goodness, the world is so bad, so evil. Come over here. We don't want to be contaminated by it. Gross. We don't want our kids to like even be around your kids because your kids just talk like crazy people. So we're going to bring our kids over here too. And what have we done? What have we done? I mean, really think about it. No one likes the word Pharisee, but that's what Pharisees did. They separated themselves. So there has to be this balance, this tension that you're wrestling with, that I'm wrestling with. I do wrestle with it in my life. Okay. God, you want us to have the church. You want us to be together. You want us to be holy. You want us to call what's evil, evil. But at the same time, you want us to be loving and kind and compassionate and gracious. You call us to be a light of the world. You call us to be salt in this world. You want us to make it, you want us to make a difference in this world and bring people to you. So if we're going to bring people to Jesus, we actually have to be around people who don't know Jesus. Right, I was reading this book, even this spiritual discipleship multiplication in the world, where it's even talking about a lot of times Christians like to do discipleship, but really what we call it, it's just called recycleship. We're just discipling the same people that someone else discipled. It's like, I want to pour into that person right there, bring them closer to Jesus. But really, discipleship at the core of what it is going to people who don't know Jesus, finding them, sharing the gospel with them, answering questions along the way, bringing them to a relationship with Jesus Christ. And now we're following Jesus together. In fact, think about this. I mean, even this title here, Fish, this comes from Bob McNabb's book, Spiritual Multiplication in the World World. You have to find people. I mean, he asked this question, could you write down 10 unbelievers right now that you engage with all the time? That you can call your friend. They're your friend. How many could you write down? He says the average is 2 to 3 unbelieving friends that Christians have. And this is where I'm being challenged, because right now I find myself in a bubble. I mean, I'm a pastor of the Grove. I hang out with Christians all the time. That's my job, and I love it. It was so much easier when I was in high school. So much easier when I played sports. I mean, it's just more natural. If we're actually going to do this inside of it, you have to strategically set aside time and find people to hang out with who are not believers. I'm praying right now about an unbeliever, and I've never done this before. I'm just saying, okay, I'm going to meet with them once a month for lunch. I'm going to tell them this, once a month for lunch, we're going to hang out, and we're just going to talk. We're going to get to know each other. We're going to talk about, I'm going to talk about what I care about. You talk about what you care about. Let's just become friends. I'm nervous about it, just so you know. I'm nervous about it. But that's what the Lord has put on my heart to do right now, from even reading and studying all these things. So we have to find, we have to take an interest in people who are unbelievers. Not just, okay, I found you. Here's the gospel. Bam, 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 bam. But actually care about them. Get to know them in their life and what's going on, what their hardship is. Also at the same time, with unbelievers, you have to share the gospel. You can't just have a bunch of unbelieving friends and not share. Look at what Jesus did. Jesus went from town to town to town, preaching the word over and over again. So we have to be well thought of by outsiders, at the same time preaching the gospel of who Jesus is, and then we help them understand and make a decision. It's not that we force their hand and tell them what to decide. We help them. Do you have any questions? The decision they make is the decision they make. God doesn't put the pressure on us for people to change their mind and accept Jesus. That's God's job. God changes people's hearts. Our job is just to share with unbelieving people the good news that changed every single one of our lives. That's part of being a follower of Jesus. This is what he wants us to do. So application questions as we close. Are you currently more like Jesus or more like the Pharisees? Tough question. I ask myself this too. Are you more running towards those who are lost, or are you separating yourself more now than ever from those who are lost? Are you more intentional to befriend sinners and more intentional to separate yourself or kids from them? How many unbelieving friends do you have? Any? Where will you find some? Who do you need to take an interest in, share the gospel, and help? What behaviors do we need to be mindful of that could put unbelievers off? If those on the outside are supposed to think of us in a good way, what things could put them off in what we say or post? If you have unbelieving friends, are you calling them to follow Jesus when you hang out with them? And the last question, are you a follower of Jesus, or are you an opponent of Jesus? In conclusion, just going over these points, we're going to sing one more song together. Jesus came to forgive us of our sins. That is our deepest need. And followers of Jesus believe that Jesus can meet our deepest need. Opponents, they don't believe it. They don't turn to him. They don't want him. And Jesus, at the same time, he is a friend of sinners. Followers of Jesus, they know this more than anyone else, because the Lord Jesus had befriended us. And therefore, we'll do whatever we can to be friends with those who don't know him. While opponents of Jesus, they begin to separate themselves from other people, and they separate themselves from God's mission. And many times, they just turn into people who judge others. That's what we see from the Pharisees. So in your life, are you following him in the way he wants you to follow? Is there any area in your life where you're in opposition to the Lord? May we look at the way that Jesus lived. May we do our best to follow him with everything that's inside of us. Let me pray as we close. Father, we come before you. We praise you. We love you. We thank you for the example that you set for each and every single one of us. And I pray, Lord, that you give us the strength to follow you as best as we can. We thank you, Lord, that you died on the cross, that you forgive us of our sins. We're thankful that you befriended us. God, help us to live for you and to live for your glory. Pray all these things in the powerful name of Jesus Christ.
Jesus, the name above every other.
us today, we have Guest Central over here. You may not have heard it before, but we are the friendliest church in America. So you can go over there and just connect with someone. We would love to get connected here at the Grove. We're going to have prayer partners up front. We are a praying church, so please, if there's anything you need prayer for, please come up front. We have our giving boxes on the way out if you are going to be giving to the tithes and offerings. And also, if you're looking to get baptized, we're going to have Andy Jebo over here that you can talk with. We love you guys. Hope you have a good one. We'll see y'all next week.